Hi, Jeff and Joelle. I hope you're doing well. How do you address barking in the crate with an eight-week-old puppy? Do you ignore it and reward when quiet?
So,
or correct?
I correct. I'll bonk the crate. Just say no and throw a bonker at the crate. I'll shake the crate. You know, what's going to the assumption that the dog does not have to go out to go to the bathroom? Okay, obviously. So you can do that. You'll be told you can't do that because of the negative association of the crate, which is false. It's an absolute lie. Did that video go out yet, or was that the one being edited?
What video?
Negative association in the crate. That's the one that's being edited.
I think Mackenzie finished it.
Okay, that's the last one we did, right? Okay. So we've got a video going out on our Patreon channel, actually, just on that. It's probably going up tomorrow on the Patreon channel. Next. Hey, we're live. How's everybody going? How's everybody doing?
Stopping by to give thanks. Continuing education for dog owners.
Awesome. Dogs just stop doing bad shit. It's incredible. And then you get to start training your dog. Good afternoon, good evening, good morning, depending where in the world you are. I hope everyone's doing fantastic. This is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training and Joelle, and this is the What Would Jeff Do show. What Would Jeff Do? It's a one-hour show from 7 to 8. We're on every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. We stream live on YouTube. And volume works this time.
Yeah.
So what people are going to be asking is pretty much how to stop unwanted behaviors. It's very, very similar and parallel to our seminar series, mm-hmm. which is how to stop unwanted behaviors. That's Jeff Gellman Seminars. You can go to Jeff Gellman Seminars. And that is most likely going to be starting back up the second half of 2020. We're going to start scheduling 2021 seminars. Might as well just put that schedule up there as well, just to get it up there. Mm. We'll probably literally just carbon copy 2020 onto 2021 and just be like, yep, just live in reality. A lot of people, what they're doing, I think, is like waiting for things to change. And I'm like, well, guess what? How about if things don't change right now? And I think you need to just work with what you have. So I think that's really, really important. It's like, you can't just sit around and wait for things to get better. You have to make things better. So it's a Q&A show. There is something at the bottom called Top Chat, and that's, actually, I owe you $2, by the way, still.
Yep, sure do.
What you want to do is, you don't have to pay to play, but you can throw a little bit of cash our way. Thank you so much for the years of free content, or your question does get to the top of the queue, but you do not have to pay to play, but we definitely much appreciate, you know, all of that. You type in the question, Joelle asks the question, I give the answer. A lot of it's going to be based on how to properly apply punishments. And I use the word punishment, you can use the word correction, use whatever words you want, but it is not reward. And it is not redirection. It is an actual something that's intolerable to the dog. And that is how you instill an inhibition in a dog. And that is how you stop an unwanted behavior. And you'll know that most dogs are put down or rehomed because of something they did not stop or the owners could not stop them from doing. Fact. Hashtag truth. All right. So, Joelle, jump right in and let's get going.
Melissa, good evening, Jeff, Joelle, and everyone in the chat.
Awesome. Good evening to you. We'll say good morning. Good evening.
Hi. Michelle, hi, everyone. Awaiting mortgage approval from underwriting. Cross your fingers with me.
All right. It's going to happen. Things are a little bit slower. Actually, we're refinancing our house. It's so funny. It's like going back to a 30-year mortgage, refinancing that damn thing. It's like, got to keep this company alive. I'm wondering if we do a show on that. It's like how we're surviving this, you know, financially, this business financially, and what people can do. I think that'd be really, really interesting to do, to help as many people out as possible. Hopefully we can, just by setting a good example of what we're doing, is helping as well. I think things are going to work out fine, and things are just working a little bit slower. It's like a catch 22. It's like you need to get it done because of COVID, but things are slowed down because of COVID. Mm. So next.
Kathy B. Oh, she crossed her fingers for Michelle.
Awesome.
That was nice.
That was nice of her.
Leanne, hi. Camping with dog this year. Site rules, must be on leash. Plan on using e-collar and GPS tracker just in case.
Good.
Would you recommend harnessing Houdini hound for tie out? What kind is best?
Well, if it's a Houdini hound, they can easily get out of... Well, first of all, let's assume your dog is going to be underneath voice control by then, but dogs can get out of harnesses really, really well. I would use, if anything, a martingale backup. just use a martingale backup, but default to dog training with a martingale backup next.
Truck driver, dog guy. One, I want my dog to, on command, stay within a 3 to 5 perimeter of my truck and freely roam within that space. I haul cars and spend a lot of time in that space loading, unloading. What would Jeff do?
I would start out with a tie out. I would start with an incredible heel and an incredible recall and become really, really valuable to the dog. But I would just have that dog tied to you. I know it can be hard because if you're actually loading a car, you know, where's the dog going to go? But I would be really concerned about you driving a car up onto one of the decks of your truck while your dog is loose, getting possibly caught in between a level and a gear and its tail, its paw, trying to jump up to get to you. The safest place is your dog in the actual truck, in the actual cab. There's a lot of distractions out there for your dog to wander off. The last thing you want to be doing is driving up the ramp on the top deck of your truck and you see your dog wandering off, and like then you open up the door and you've got like 10 feet down. There's nowhere for you to go. So let's be practical. I mean, I want a lot of things, you know, that doesn't mean it's going to happen. What I want you to do is how much time do you spend loading and unloading compared to actually transporting? So I think the time in the cab is going to be the most valuable, but you can also just role play it. Just role play the heck out of it. Do it when you're actually not like pressed for time and you're in a secure fenced in area, and role play. But have a really good recall. So if you notice that your dog is wandering off, just the stem of the collar gets that dog to come back next.
That thing made a difference tonight with the lighting.
Yeah, here. Yeah, it really did. Yeah, I picked up a darkening blind. It's so funny because at Job Lot today, all they had was the 84-inch long blinds, and I'm like, you're under the assumption that everybody needs, like, was there a run on the kitchen ones? Was there a run on the shorter ones? So, and
we just cut the damn thing.
Well, I actually went in the back, and I thought we had some Gorilla Tape, because I know I got a couple of rolls for Kristen, because she loves her Gorilla Tape. She probably does. So much that it's gone. She probably has fixed a bunch of stuff with it.
Puts fact, it on everything.
The daycare wall might be held up by it for all we know. Everything. So that's all we know. So I just ended up cutting it. Yeah.
What were you going to use tape for?
I was going to just fold it up and then tape the back.
That would look terrible from the outside.
I don't give a shit from the outside. Number one, you can't see it from the outside because there's a fucking curtain there. There's a shade there. But number two, I don't care what it looks like behind the scenes.
Well, you should.
Okay. And in the Hollywood sets, in the Broadway productions, it looks like nothing. It's the front of the house that it looks like everything.
Whatever.
Next.
Truck driver dog guy said, and good evening, J&J.
Good evening. How are you?
Leanne, or should I just use a jogging leash, umbilical theory, and keep him tied to me in sight?
Yeah, I could. Or you just use a stakeout, or put him, just tie it to a tree, and just teach him a good down. You know, I mean, that's what I would do next.
Kathy B, hi J&J, Michelle, and all in chat.
Hey, how's everybody doing? Hope everyone's having a fantastic day. It's been a really, really great. What is today? Wednesday? It's been a great week.
I'm just sitting here like, what day is it?
It's Wednesday.
Wednesday.
Yeah. Kira, that's enough water.
I know, she really like, okay, no, you know it's what? Girl.
Girl, you've had water
before. She's thirsty.
Before. I know. Settle
Let
down.
Let the woman drink.
Next.
Cheryl, hi Jeff, Joelle, Melissa, and everyone in chat. Happy hump day. I love how everyone like lists each other's names. Soon enough, it's going to be like.
Everybody. And Tom and Jack.
Roll call.
Which is telling Mr. Rogers. Hey, Timmy, yeah. I see you. Hey.
Sandy, hey everybody. Charles says good evening.
Have you ever seen the documentary about Mr. Rogers?
No.
It's a really, really good documentary. Yes.
Cool.
It's an excellent one.
Was he like normal?
We'd have to define normal, but what he did for he actually is responsible for public broadcasting still being funded. He sat before Congress and literally made sure that PBS did not get shut down single-handedly. Him.
Wow.
His speech got the funding. Literally, there's a great. If anybody wants to look for it, it's a black and white video. It's you can YouTube it, and it's really, really powerful. And
Mr. Rogers.
Yeah,
man.
And he's actually, yeah, it's a great, great, great documentary about him.
What was his actual
name? First name is Mr., second name is Rogers.
Charles says good evening.
Good evening.
Tag later, Dr. Hey, guys, glad to be here.
Glad to have you here.
Holding on, dog training. Hey, Ashley. Happy hump day. Got coffee ready for a great show.
Good.
Good job with your box jumps today. I'm so proud of you.
I thought about... yes, I saw that video. You're looking really, really good, Ash. I thought about having a coffee right before this show.
Me too. That would have made like 12 for today.
I know. Yeah.
I've had so many coffees.
I've noticed. I'm like, God damn, I open up a new package every day and it's empty. Literally... It's empty.
Well, think about it. Just in the morning, between you and me, there's four. Boom, right there. We both have a double shot first thing in the morning.
I actually have five.
Jesus
I have three.
Christ.
I mean three. I
All
do
right.
two before the workout, and then one while I'm getting dressed. So that's five.
That's
half.
A lot.
That's half the 10 right there. Right.
And then I always have my after workout coffee.
Yeah, exactly.
Lunch.
Yep.
Midday. It's so bad.
It's really bad.
I should really like do a detox, but I wouldn't come to work. I would need like a week of just like. Nobody talk to me.
We don't need that.
Leave
okay?
me the fuck
Okay?
Off.
I've already seen like a day of that out of you when we travel. Next.
I really should do it though.
Sure.
Michelle Anderson, good evening, Jeff and Joelle. Hope all is well. Love seeing Angelo back at work and making me smile.
Yeah. Yeah. Angelo, he's been tired the last couple of days. In fact, we talked about him doing his podcast. In fact, his controllers on his the Nintendo Switch, we had to order them. We had to order new controllers because the little side controllers that come off. There's a little screen there.
Yeah.
One of them is out of sync, and Ben couldn't fix it. So, and what a Nintendo Switch? What a fucking price hike that has had.
That thing right over there?
Yeah. That's selling for $547 right now. That's a $299 piece of equipment.
Why is it so much?
Selling for $547. Why?
Why is the thing out of sync, too?
But you know why it's selling so much for so much? Where can you not buy it from? Every fucking game store there is, they're closed.
That's true.
So you buy them online. Literally, they've almost doubled the price on them. Yeah. Yeah. That's like,
wow
is right. Next.
Dakota Sitz says, hello, everyone.
Hello, how are you?
Hello. Pack leader dog training. With your board and trains, you crate them right away, right? So when you get a separation anxiety dog in, do you end up crating them and correcting the anxiety in the crate right away?
Yes. And well, I mean, when they first come in, we do a little bit of leash work. We do a little bit of like walk around. We'll probably take them out to go to the potty. But within the first hour of a dog arriving on our property, yes, they're crated. And if they're acting like a dick, we undick them. Next.
Undick them.
Yep.
Sandy, I just found y'all on here. Love it. Great advice. New mom of a Rottweiler, 10 weeks.
Awesome. You're the new owner of a Rottweiler. Let's start out right there, not the mom. Let's start this out right, okay? And lots of food training right now, food and marker training. Tons and tons of structure. Watch the affection, but tons of structure. Everything is a routine. And crate that dog when you're not doing anything with it. Next.
Kathy B, contemplating opening a dog daycare training center. COVID got my job April 1st.
So, just to let you know, you're not going to be playing with dogs all day long. You're going to be cleaning up shit, stopping dog fights, dealing with employees, and then also you're running a business. Mm. You're running a business. Literally, we were talking about this today, about one of our seminar sit-downs, about like, just because we'll come up with a... You'll have to sit and watch it, but it's like literally you can spend $200 a month on cleaning product easily, just on cleaning product,
mm-hmm.
And that includes the chemicals, the paper towels, the getting a new mop,
nonstop.
If that's what you want to do, just pivot a little bit, just pivot. Just get into, if you want to get in the dog business, get in the dog business. There is no great time. I shouldn't say that. Let me rephrase that. It's always a great time to start a new business. You should start a new business in the middle of COVID. Because all these fuckers out there that are getting punched in the face right now, they've all had it too easy. All of them. Every single one of them. Every one of them has had it too easy. And now let's see who survives.
it's the same thing as like the hate. We talked about that the other day. It's like, yep, pile on Jeff. And then they get one negative review and they cry like little bitches. It's like, oh, you got a one-star review. Poor you. You know, I remember you back when you were fucking joining on the fucking I Hate Gellman bandwagon writing shit about me. It's like, it's the same thing. It's like until you get punched in the face, you don't know what it's really about. So Now is a great time to start a business. It's a wonderful time to start a business. Next.
Robin G. Hey, that's my mom's name. Can a dog with prey drive that attacked and killed a cat in a home be rehabbed and learn to live with cats, not my dog or my home?
It all depends on the dog and the owner and the skill set behind the training. Mr. Rogers is Fred Rogers.
I saw.
Yeah, I knew that too. I knew that.
Sure you did.
Yeah.
You said Mr.
I know. But I'm just saying though.
It's on his birth certificate, M-I-S-T-E-R.
I think the doctor just wrote MR. He was in a rush. Next.
Meet like, your son, Mr. Rogers.
Right.
Gretchen, hi guys. Nice tan, Joelle. Wait, yes. Thank you. But did you learn, did you answer that?
What was question? The question? The cat? Yeah. Yes, I did.
You did?
Yes,
okay. I did. Yeah. I just tuned you out. Yep.
Thanks.
Jessica, part of Joelle's Fit Fam, is here. Hey, Jess. Gretchen, I'm playing with baby goats while I listen.
Awesome. Oh, Gretchen, that's awesome. Gretchen, by the way, I emailed you back. I emailed you back, Gretch. And it was a serious email, by the way. Next. And I have not crossed you off the list. I would consider you, but there's some heavy talking to have. I've got to have the dad talk with you.
Could always use some baby goats around here.
Yep, next.
Melissa posted the link to my Patreon channel.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you, Melissa, for plugging Joelle's business. Marco. Which was started during COVID. Just to let you know that.
Because Joelle doesn't know how to have free time.
No, it's because we brainstormed and we started to do a business during COVID, you know? Mm-hmm. So, next. We're starting a lot of new projects during COVID.
Good time.
Yeah, our Patreon channel is... We will have doubled the content variety in our Patreon channel during COVID. We are coming up with all kinds of programs, and we're coming up with some online learning, and... It's just interesting. It's just really, really interesting. And it's like, and today, both Airbnb and Uber announced, you know, 25% of their workforce being furloughed. Laid off. So it's really, really interesting how, you know, industries, you know, they flow. And we're pivoting on my rental homes in Florida. So instead of them, the Florida houses being, you know, destinations, like you're not flying from Germany to my house, and people do all the time. So we're literally turning them into, we're repivoting into marketing them as staycations. It's like, yeah, it's a 3-bedroom, 2-bath house with a swimming pool. Like, you know, and it's like, if there's a great place to hang out there, you know, because even there's people in Florida that don't have swimming pools. So it's like, great, come here. We got swimming pools, you know. Next.
Marco, any tips on teaching a dog heel?
Yeah, I've got free videos on that. So watch my free videos. That's the best place to start, actually. Next.
Andy Rose, it's been a while. Yes, it has. Hope you two are keeping well.
Yeah, things are really, really well. Everybody in the company is healthy. Everyone's doing well. Angelo's back to work. We talked about him doing a podcast tomorrow, but I think we might do it another day because tomorrow I've got my Zoom I just remembered. Next.
Kathy B., we camp and use X-Pens for our dogs. They can get out of them, but we train them not to.
Yeah. So if you do camping like that, X-Pens are good, and you can easily train them not to, or just put them on a tie-out. Next.
David, working with an excessive whiner. I have tried correcting with e-collar, working level, correction level, going low to high to low. He continues to vocalize through the correction no matter what. Tips?
So this is for anxiety in a crate? Is it
an excessive whiner?
Excessive whiner. I think what you've got to do is, you know, you've always have your, there's always dogs out there that are whining. You have to look at your total day. What's the day look like with the dog? Hold the dog accountable for everything. Have a lot of structure for everything. Don't let the dog get away with, you know, any nonsense at all. Teach that dog, do some, a lot of duration work with that dog. And then on your remote, yes, you're like, you're fish, it's called fish, I call it fishing. You're fishing for that right combination of, you know, stuff to stop the whining. Cut down on affection. Next.
Truck driver, dog guy said rats. Thanks for the advice.
You're welcome. Yeah. I just want your dog to be safe, Nathan. That's it. I just want your dog to be safe. And I'm familiar with your job. In fact, we've got a couple of car carriers that park right down the street from us when they're not working. They literally leave their trucks there. So I'm familiar. And then they load them up. There's a couple of your 18-wheelers, and then we've got two of the ones that are pulled by pickup trucks that are just one level that hold probably three or four cars. Next.
Marco, last question. Is it okay for a dog to sleep on the placemat, or is kennel preferred?
You can do whatever you want to do. I mean, dogs end up falling asleep on the placemat. I'm a huge advocate of the crate. For like go to bed, you know, nighttime, like lights out, go in your crate. I'm just a big fan of that. But you can have your dog sleep on the placemat. You can have your dog sleep in bed with you. I mean, I'm not against that. I'm more concerned with what are the behavioral issues. And when we have the behavioral issues, then we can start tying certain rules into that. So anybody with any major behavioral issues, I believe, should be crating their dog. Next.
Lillian, hi, using microeducator on my Chihuahua for barking. Going well, she won't bark with the collar on, seems to know when the collar is off, and she will bark. Tips on getting results with or without?
Yeah, what I want you to do is use a marker word and say no and then correct. Make the word no powerful. You can also use a bonker for barking as well. The big thing is the no. Also, how long have you been using it? So have you been using it for days, weeks, months? Next.
Jessica, hi J&J. What is the proper regimen to rebalance your dog? Some issues being dealt with, resource guarding, growling everywhere in the house while he's laying around, seems to have no sense of relax.
So resource guarding is, number one, that's stopped pretty quick. You can stop resource guarding in about, I don't know, 3 seconds, but let's call it a minute, you know. It's also going to be about the rest of the day. So you might be spending a week more on the punishment side than you are on anything else. Just like, you know, literally, or it's going to look like whack-a-mole. You're like, you know, got rid of that behavior and a new one pops up. Got rid of that behavior, new one pops up. It's almost like a war of wills, you know, at some point. And you just need to get ahead of it. You need to get ahead of it. Next.
Lillian said collar. That was part of the thing, with or without the collar.
For what?
With the barking.
Oh, okay, got it.
Sarah, hi Jeff and Joelle. I hope you're doing well. How do you address barking in the crate with an 8-week-old puppy? Do you ignore it and reward when quiet?
So, correct? I correct. I'll bonk the crate. Just say no and throw a bonker at the crate. I'll shake the crate. You know, what's going to the assumption that the dog does not have to go out to go to the bathroom? Okay, obviously. So you can do that. You'll be told you can't do that because of the negative association of the crate, which is false. It's an absolute lie. Did that video go out yet, or was that the one being edited?
What video?
Negative association in the crate. That's the one that's being edited.
I think Mackenzie finished
it. Okay, that's the last one we did, right? Okay. So we've got a video going out on our Patreon channel, actually, just on that. It's probably going up tomorrow on the Patreon channel. Next.
Jasmine, thanks for all the help and the free content. I got a lady be amazed at how my 8-month-old puppy is off-leash trained and trained so well. She was like, I wish my two dogs could be like yours.
Well, you know, there's a couple of responses to that. You can just look her straight and square in the eyes, and in your really, in your kindest voice, most loving voice ever, just say, stop being such a lazy fuck then. And what you can do is, out of all seriousness, well, that was the serious answer. What you can actually do is you can say is, yeah, I've spent a lot of time training my dog. My dog did not come to me like this. I've spent hours and hours and hours, hundreds of hours training my dog. I've spent thousands of repetitions. I've spent a lot of time doing this. And your dogs also can be like this too. But it takes, you know, a lot of work. You know, this concept that dogs just come out trained is bullshit. Next.
Yeah. Hannah used my e-collar for the first time with the command come. It was choppy at first, but after reps, she caught on. Amazing to see how well we went from being stubborn to listening. Thanks for the videos.
Yeah. I mean, it takes hundreds of reps. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of reps. And also make sure you get to correction level, which is a very high level, or else you'll have a dog that will not know what to do when it blows through a normal level. Next.
Gretchen said Mr. Rogers was one of a kind.
Yes, he was.
Lou said, hi, J&J, just checking in.
Hey, Lou, thanks. Thanks for checking in with us. It's really important. It's always great to hear from all of you. Really, really, really is. I I'm sarcastic, and I bust a lot of balls, but I truly, truly love, hearing from all of you. Next.
Barista Boy, I love that documentary. He was definitely a little out there, but was a really interesting person. I love the piano scene when he played with his wife, the duet. And yeah. LOL, I don't know his first name, just Mr. Fred Rogers.
I think Fred was, Cheryl. I think anybody that's out there is pretty amazing. I mean, a lot of people will say that Elon Musk is out there. It's like,
you're out there.
It's like, yeah. Do you mean the guy that's actually sending rockets to the to Mars? Yeah. Do you mean the guy that's building tunnels underneath Los Angeles with high speed, modular vehicles? And yeah. Do you mean the guy that invented the electric, that's designing and producing and selling electric cars? Yeah. I think it takes a special breed of person to come up with some of the most incredible things we have, on this earth right now. Next.
Max and Tubbs, GSD's rule. Either scared or protecting us, but it hurt my shoulder so much I'd love him to stop lunging. Okay, I feel like there was more than that, but I don't see
it. So, is there a breed? Is there a name or what was the intro to that?
That was their name.
Oh. So, if you want your dog to stop lunging, you can train it to stop lunging. Number one, let's give you a little bit of leverage, and let's get the dog on a prong collar. Eventually get your dog on a remote collar just to help you out a little bit because, you were injured on that. And let's start you out on some good baseline healing in a low distraction area. And I've got free videos on all of this stuff on my YouTube channel. And if anyone's looking for a couple of people have asked, hey, where are all those new do-it-yourself 2020 videos? Just let everybody know those have been permanently moved to our Patreon channel. Permanently. But you can still see tons of free content, like 3,500 free videos on YouTube. But a lot of our stuff is being moved over to a paid format. Meanwhile, we put up 7-8 posts a day on our free stuff. But some of our more complete stuff is definitely going over to a paid channel, which is like, because that's just how we've pivoted. Next.
Crescent Moon Girl. Hi, my Great Dane 1 bit my nephew 4 over a toy. They're playing toss, and when he went to get the ball, he bit him. They played together since he was 8 weeks, never had a problem. What do I do?
Well, I mean, I think that was just wrong face in the wrong place at the wrong time. That's what it probably sounds like. Right? They were playing ball together, and the dog went for the ball and got the kid instead. That's what it sounds like it happens. So I don't know. I wasn't there. What can you do? Dogs, I mean, I've broken up a dog fight before where my dog was involved and my own dog has bitten my leg and I've been like, what the hell? It's like, and my dog doesn't bite me. It just, my leg was in the wrong spot at the wrong time. And dogs, when they're fighting, they're not thinking of like what, appendage is there. They're biting it. So I think that it could have been that. I don't know. If your dog was resource guarding the ball and went after the 4-year-old, that's a different story. Next.
Ara, I'm going to try bonking method on my 6-month-old GSD for leash reactivity on dogs. Do you think I can bonk him in my driveway when a dog passes by, or better in a neutral place like a street walk?
There's an art to bonking. You do it at the loading phase. You can actually bonk your dog. So bonking is only part of the formula. It's part of the formula. And what it is it's part of the total rehab of the dog. And what you're doing is you're saying no. What you're really doing is teaching the dog the word no is what you're doing. It's just an inhibitor. It's a very powerful inhibitor. That's what it really is. That's why you say no, you wait 1 or 2 seconds, and then you bonk. And what you do is you're doing it at the first sign of arousal. But you can do it. You walk out your front door of your house. If your dog is already scanning, you can say no and then bonk then. It's called the pre-walk bonk. And a lot of people will struggle with that concept because the dog's not lunging. It's like, well, if you're an alcoholic and you're trying to be, trying to rehab, I'm not going to wait until you're drunk to start giving you the education or the intervention. I'm going to stop you prior to walking into the bar. Next.
Mm-hmm. truck driver dog guy, stubborn bull mastiff, NCS working level challenges. He ignores it until 20, then complies. Next time, jerks like it's too hot and freezes. If I turn it down to, say, 16, 17, just ignores it. Thoughts?
So I think the NC, number one, make sure you, 20 is not that high, just to let you know. So, you know, make sure you've got the right fit. Make sure your contact points are fitting right and it's snug enough. And the NCS, which is non-compliant stim, it's part of our training program, CS to NCS, actually leash and prong to remote collar CS to NCS, then to, you know, eventually to just correction for non-compliance. And NCS is you are gradually dialing up. So going from, say, 15 to 20 till the dog goes, whoa, okay, I feel that, is normal. It's normal. Also, when you're outside with different environmentals, you know, it's
also, there's a lot of variables. Also, though, once you dial up to 20, dial back down.
Dial back down,
it's
right.
A lot different when you're gradually going up, right. Or if you're just starting there, the dog's like, whoa.
Yes, yes.
It's a different sensation. So what you're doing sounds right, but just remember to dial back down.
Yes, yes. A lot of people forget to dial back down. They think that 20 is the new level, but it's like, no. You finally got your dog's attention.
That was just enough to get him motivated.
Right. Now go back down. In fact, you might actually be going back down lower than 15.
Once you get their attention.
Yeah. Many times at seminars, we'll have a dog that, like, working levels at, say, 14, and I'm like, okay. And believe it or not, within 2 minutes, we're down to 4.
Mm-hmm.
Because the dog is just in tune.
J. Jordan Jones, any scenarios for reactive, fear, aggressive, nervy, 14 male? Female? 14 male, female? What does that mean?
14-month-old male?
I guess.
Okay.
She hasn't been loading to people coming in the house from the crate, passing fence dogs.
So, I mean, there's a lot of strategies you can do. Number one, it's going to involve, you know, if you have a Malinois, you want to definitely have a higher level of training because it is a Mal. There's just, sort of like one of those responsibility things, I think. I mean, it takes a special person to own a Mal and to work with a Mal. So what I think is what you want to be doing is definitely correcting the loading part, really get a really, really great heel out of that dog. The thing about a Mal is when they're focused on something, they really don't care about corrections a lot of times. They really don't care. A bonker has been a great correction for a Mal. It's something that they've never usually experienced. A lot of Mals can blow through remote collars quite easily. Next.
Sandy, thank you. Yes, correction owner, LOL. I have one question I could not find on any of your videos. So in-house cats, he likes to chase. I correct not doing so.
So I've talked about it, I don't know, at least 1,000 times probably on social media. I might not have a video on it. I don't have videos on everything. You can always do a Skype. That's like how you get my attention is like we do. You can ask me any question you want. You're asking it now. So there's a couple of different thought processes between cat and dog stuff. If your dog is chasing the cat with intent to harm, I personally put the dog into avoidance. I make it extremely uncomfortable for that dog to go after the cat. I think people need to understand when I say things like that, I'm not angry, I'm not mad, I'm not upset, I'm not yelling. I'm turning my remote collar up to a very high setting. I'm saying no, I'm pushing a button. I'm letting that do all the talking for me. And I'm neutral. I am neutral. And I think that's really, really important. Next.
J. Jordan Jones, took her on a structured walk with a similar tempered but non-aggressive male, and it was stressful. They ended up playing together and walking back on the same side.
So, you know, first of all, number one, a lot of things in life are stressful, dog training being one of them, rehab being another one, life right now being another one. I think what you want to do is, to me, that sounds like pretty damn good, though, because if that was all in one session, that's pretty good. Like, if you accomplished stressful walk to walking on the same side in one session, I would call that success. So don't be too hard on yourself. Keep in mind, when you see us, we've got two fighting bully breeds with us right now that can cause some serious damage and have caused some serious damage. And they're walking side by side or side by each, depending on what part of the state they're in. And if you're a New Englander, you understand that. And I believe today they were off muzzle walking side by side. But humongous hundreds of hours of training have gone into that.
Yeah.
Hundreds of hours of training have gone into that. So, and the owners will never do that. Mm-hmm. We've already told the owners, nor do they want to. These dogs will always be muzzled when they're out of their crate together. And when I say always, that doesn't necessarily mean 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years from now, 5 years from now. But whenever we have a client, I like to really be realistic. And let's just assume that one activity is forever. What's the big deal? Your dogs were kept alive. Meanwhile, I had to do an end-of-life consult this morning, literally in the job lot parking lot. Mm. You know what I mean? Literally, I walked somebody through how to, they'd have to put down their dog. So I did that this morning. So it's like, you know, like that's the other outcome of it. And I've got a lot of empathy for people that do. I'm not one of these people that like, you know, oh, find a sanctuary, find another home. It's like nobody wants a certain type of dog. I won't get into the details because it was a very personal, you know, a private phone call. But the whole end of life conversation, I mean, there is a time when your dog needs to go. And when it can't be safe enough in the community, well, it can't be safe enough in your house or in the community enough. And a lot of people will shame them, I'm sure. Yeah. But I have huge empathy for a lot of folks that are struggling with that. Next.
Gretchen, I saw mulling that over. You have good points.
Thank you. And I'm glad I got your attention. Next. And I'm more than happy to have a phone call with you too, Gretch. Okay? Just make sure you're not in your house when you call me. Next. I'm being serious.
David, thanks Jeff and Joelle for all that you do.
You're welcome. Thanks for watching, listening, and if you're engaging with us and if you're using any of our advice. Next.
Jessica, new to your channel, loving it. Got a pup, Maltese, 4 months, 3 pounds. I want to start a slip lead leash on her soon. What do you think? Too early? Thank you for teaching me place. She follows me everywhere.
So how old's the dog?
4 months.
So it's 16 weeks old. So, I mean, I would do all food training right now. Just do all food training. That's everything we do is we do food and clicker training. We clicker train every dog, but a puppy, we would clicker train every puppy. Next.
Abandoned entity. My dad decided to add a rottie to our family on a whim. He acts like he has never grown out of being a puppy. Very pushy and bratty. We recently found out he's also guarding food, so I know he needs to learn out. But are there other subtle things that need to be specifically corrected with pushy dogs? My personal dog is driven to work, so pushy dogs make me scratch my head a little bit.
Yeah, when you get a pushy, snotty dog, you have to unpushy snot them. And you do that.
It's so funny, like, that it happens to be a Rottweiler. Yeah, we have one in right now.
Yeah, and you do
pretty similar.
Yeah, and what you do is you just show intense leadership, and nothing in life is free. And you will start. I would start with literally how you go into a crate and come out of a crate. How you go through a threshold, come out of a threshold. How you need to hold your commands. How you correct the pushiness. Correct the pushiness. So, you know, it's like, it's important that people understand that there's fearful, nervous dogs, there's pushy, snotty dogs, and working with a pushy, snotty dog, you correct that. That's actually a correction-based theory that you're going to be working on. Next.
Melanie, how is separation anxiety Max doing? Our newest greyhound adopted 326, never alone before, bad separation anxiety already. Crate training 2 times a day minimum. E-collar agitated him more. Bonker it is. We're 3 weeks in, so hopeful. Thanks.
So when Max is with us, he does extremely well. He falls right to sleep wherever he is, and he sleeps through the night. At Max's house, there is some regression, but overall, Max is doing 100 times better. But thousands of hours of rehab went into Max. Thousands of hours. And I think it's important that people understand that when, you know, your average separation anxiety dog is one night stopped, but there are dogs out there that take a long time. Next.
Andy, what is your experience with dogs in heat? Are your female dogs intact or are they spayed?
So Kira is intact, and my experience with it is just she's intact, and there's not many behavioral differences at all. The other dogs, there's some interest from that are in our pack. There's 5 dogs that are in the combination of our pack. So we're, you know, I'd be more concerned about just like an off leash dog, you know, a little bit of sniffing gets corrected. And other than that, everything seems to be fine. Thanks.
Hey, Battaglia. Hey, hey. Saving my questions for my first Patreon tomorrow. Foster and Lucy have been doing great. I hope all is well. Sending you lots of laughter, love, and positive vibes your way.
Well, thank you. It'll be great to see you on Patreon. If people don't know how to get onto Patreon, just go to patreon.com/solidcaninetraining. I'm sure Melissa will put up a link to the Patreon channel, and we've got a Zoom that we do at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And there's a link that will be posted tomorrow morning on literally, like, you click on the link, make sure your camera and microphone are on, and it just takes you right to the room. And I see you.
Right, like, to the Zoom room.
Literally, I see you. Just like you're seeing us, I see you. Next. And that's what's great about it. We literally can go back and forth, and we can engage, and it's a two-way conversation. Next.
Melanie, also bonk for whining if he's laying down and otherwise calm. Just bonk if up and barking.
For what, the 8-week old?
I think so.
Yeah, just no, and then bonk the crate. Next. You can shake the crate, hit the crate with a food bowl. Next.
You ran. Hey, J&J, I have a 7-month-old Belgian Malinois who's aggressive with kids running and also dogs. He lunges, barks. I tried bonking, but it didn't seem to work.
No, it won't.
Can't get e-collar. I live in Kosovo.
Mm-hmm.
Tips.
You can get an e-collar. It's just not legal, but you can get one. There's an underground market in every industry to get everything, okay? So you can buy a tank if you wanted to. You just have to know the right you have to just know the right people. So,
oh, my God.
Well, you can.
I don't think so.
The dark web, you can get anything you want. So you can get an e-collar. Anyway, when the Mal, you've got to, but just remember, dogs were trained before remote collars, but it was heavy compulsion. So it's heavy compulsion to stop an unwanted behavior. So, you know, what's the dog? The dog's reactive. Okay, the dog's reactive. We don't know if he's aggressive unless he's bitten kids, but it's his prey drive kicking in. So at the first sign of loading, a huge correction has to happen. And the bonk should be very, very firm. Next.
Melissa posted the link to your Patreon channel.
Thank you.
Molly. Hi, guys. Wanted to share a success story. After 3 weeks of bonking, remote collar, Skype, and very little sleep, our dog finally sleeps soundly in his kennel. 8 to 10 hours a night. Thank you.
Awesome. Proud of you.
Next. Awesome. Melissa. Hi, J&J. Longtime lurker here. I joined Patreon, and I'm loving all the fantastic content. Thank you both for awesome. All that you do. It's greatly appreciated and very inspirational.
Awesome. Yeah, Patreon has all original content, all different content, I should say. So there's content that's put up there almost daily that you will not see anywhere else on any of our social media platforms. Next.
Cindy said, how do I join Patreon?
Go to Patreon. I'm sure there's been a link since you've asked the question, but patreon.com/solidcaninetraining. There's different tiers in which we get you different things. Next.
Truck driver, dog guy. Thanks, Joelle. Dial back down is what I missed.
Yes. Thank you. That's a good point that you brought that up. A lot of people forget to do that. And it's not just on NCS stage. It's no different than if a dog starts chasing something and you have to dial up. And then you're like, you forget to dial back down, or you're doing disobedience inside, but there's a high level distraction and you're like, oh shit, I forgot to dial back down. It happens and it's no big deal. No. It's no big deal at all. It's like when I run a 2-dog remote, like Tex and Kira, and I hit the wrong button and the wrong dog screeches. I'm like, oh shit, wrong button. So it's like they get over it quick. Next.
Barista boy, one thing that is nice is that every time I watch these lives, it gets a little lighter outside, even though they are calling for snow next week.
Yeah, it's actually
good. Where do you live?
Yeah, probably Michigan. Next.
Water. Really?
Yeah.
Hannah, so are you saying once they get it on a higher number, turn it down after the dog gets the command? Because inside is a 4 for command and 14 outside for a command. Should I be dialing up and down more?
I think you should listen to the dog. Put tape over the numbers and watch and pay attention to the dog. The dog will always tell you what the right number is. Okay? But historically, more environmentals, numbers are usually higher. Just remember that. Next.
Gretchen, yes, might be good to wait till the library opens back up.
Or just walk down the street. I'm sure you're allowed to leave your house. Next.
Jessica, thank you. We'll continue.
Cool.
Crescent Moon Girl. For the Dane, it wasn't an accident. My dog had started chewing the ball after catching it, and my nephew was getting it from him. They've done this hundreds of times with no issues.
Okay. So your Dane needs to learn out, and your 4-year-old is old enough to say the word out. You role play it. You run the remote. and teach your four-year-old not to do that anymore. So, next.
Andrea, 1.5-year-old male lab showing signs of being territorial. Playing with other dogs in a structured daycare will attack another dog for no reason other than being in his territory.
That's the reason. So
it happens randomly.
So let's not go back to there's no reason. There is a reason. The reason is the other dog is in what the attacking dog's perceived territory is. Meanwhile, I don't think that dog is paying rent at the doggy daycare. So it's not their territory. Okay, it's the land, it's the owner of the company's territory. So what you do is you can correct it. So it's possible that a lot of doggy daycares, dogs are running around all amped up, and it's not conducive to good behavior a lot of times. But there is a reason. That's the reason. Next.
Hannah, my dog has been attacked in our neighborhood by other dogs while we were walking. Sad people cannot control their dogs. My dog is becoming aggressive with dogs now.
Correct.
Any tips?
Correct. Yeah. Start kicking the dogs that attack your dog before they make contact with your dog. But that is it's one of the biggest reasons why dogs start becoming leash reactive and aggressive is because off-leash dogs are attacking them. That's why whenever anybody says, what do I do when an off-leash dog is going to attack them, I say you kick hard, you kick with intention. And if anybody struggles with that, you've never seen a dog killed in front of you. And God forbid it's your dog, and I hope you never have to experience that, let alone breaking up a dog fight. What you can do now is get your dog around safe dogs and advocate for your dog and make sure you're working with dogs that know how to move away from you and your dog. Like a proper socialization, like what we have here. Next.
Jessica, thanks for the guidance. Follow-up question about the out command with e-collar tie back. Should I switch to kibble from raw, or does it matter? Want more time to land the command. He's a food scarfer.
It doesn't matter. Out is out. You can just do more repetitions if you have to. Next.
Cindy, getting ready to join Patreon. Looking forward to it. I've watched many trainers and chose to follow your training. Thanks. I have hope.
Cool. So yeah, make sure you get ready, shower, put on some nice clothes, do your hair, get really, really ready, and then just push that button. Next.
Abandoned entity. I've been starting on crate thresholds already. He definitely knows when I'm on the other end of the leash. My family like to say I'm a drill sergeant with my boy, but he's very attentive.
Good. Yeah. Usually people will say that, but then they'll also love how well-behaved the dog is. Next.
You ran. Yeah, he bit a kid. Not a full bite, but it left a mark. Thanks for the tip. Love you guys.
Yeah, it sucks. Love you too.
Doran, I have a 2-year-old Caucasian Shepherd, which I've just adopted in January. The problem is he's like a wild animal when I put a leash on him. Bites the leash, and I'm afraid he'll bite me.
Mm-hmm. Bonk him. So you bonk the dog, you heel tap the dog, you pet convince, you correct that. The act of biting the leash, you correct. Next.
Melanie, follow up for the crate training, separation anxiety, greyhound. It's great overnight in the room in a crate with us at night, sleeps without a peep. Problem is when we leave the room or right. House, nanny cam in use can't bonk from afar. What to do?
So you shouldn't be, if you're trying to stop a separation anxiety dog, the dog should be out of your room totally overnight. And you should put a remote collar on your dog and you'll work on it then. Because if the dog is sleeping in the crate next to you at night, there's no separation anxiety training going on. Separation anxiety is when you're separated from the dog. So leverage the nighttime routine as a good training ground. Start there. Next.
Hannah, my dog is now making smarter decisions since using the e-collar. I can see him contemplating decisions and choosing the correct action now. Game changer. Thanks.
Good job. Excellent.
Gerardo, I'm out here training my GSD while listening to your podcast. He's very driven and motivated when I have a ball in my hand. Any suggestions on training him when he's in drive?
Dog with the ball. Yeah, use the ball. Leverage the ball. Make the ball the reward. Make the ball the reward. Hide the ball, and then that's the reward. Next.
Mothman, Do you have to do end-of-life consultations very often? Huge amounts of empathy for owners in that situation, I can't imagine.
I do a couple a week. I do a couple a week now. So, it's the world we live in. It's the world we live in. That's the reality. Next.
Fad. Hey, guys, I just wanted to say hi. My wife, Season, can't wait to see you guys at a seminar when they start up again. Glad you guys are doing well. Keep up the good work.
Awesome. Yep. We'll be there. Not sure when, but we'll be there.
Someday.
Yeah. Knoxville's this weekend. No, it's not. Next.
Barista boy. Upstate New York in the middle of frickin' nowhere, about an hour from the Canadian border.
Yep.
Cold, but peaceful. More cows than people in my town, and a huge wind farm and all the west edge of the Adirondacks.
Got it.
Wow.
Yep.
That's
up there. It's not that bad, though. I mean, it's not that far away. That's close to us. We can take 90. We can take 90 to get there. It's before Buffalo. Next.
Ara, non-training question. Why the hell do all these other YouTube trainers pretend they never correct a dog with harsh leash pop or high-level remote?
Well, some of them don't. You know, some of them don't do it at all. And the other ones are lying about it. And the reason why they don't talk about it is because they don't want the massive amounts of pushback and hate that follows it. That's why. I just find it unethical. I just find it highly unethical for a trainer that's doing something to either, number one, deny doing it or to educate the owners on how to properly do it. And to be honest with how they stopped an unwanted behavior. And then I think it's also important that if you're working with a client's dog, to be even more honest, because just because a dog does something for you, will it do it for the owner? And that's another thing that dog trainers don't talk about at all. The trainer is leveraging the relationship they have with the dog to get the results, but it doesn't pass on to the owner, because the owner has a toxic relationship. That's why the dog has to be trained on tools and understand the word no, and not be based on the relationship between the trainer and the dog, but be based on a methodical training system that can be easily baton handed off to the owner that they can duplicate, because their relationship sucks with their dog. Next.
Max and Tubbs, regarding lunging, 16-month-old GSD on a prong, tried bonking, but has really high prey drive. E-collars banned. How do we handle his prey drive? Love your live tips. Thank you so much.
So number one, try, even though they're banned, you can still probably get one. Hide it with a bandana. Number two, you want to be bonking the dog before it goes into drive. Before it goes into drive. Also, your leash pops, you would have to give a very firm one. I want people to understand, before we had all these tools, most dogs were trained on choke chains. Most dogs were trained on choke chains. Okay? Talk to any trainer that trained in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. Dogs that were leash reactive were trained with a rubber hose, leash, choke chain, and incredible amount of compulsion for doing behavior like that. I don't think people understand the banning of tools is going to either, number one, end up with lots of dead dogs, or number two, going back to truly old school ways. Because if you think you're going to stop leash reactivity with a reward-based system reliably, it's not going to happen. It's just not. And I'm sure there's a dog out there that it has worked for, but let's see Joe Public do it. And that's who owns these dogs, is Joe Public. So it's important that you give them the tools. But dogs were trained pretty harshly, and they did okay. And that's what we are going to go back for if this wave of banning of tools goes away. If people think that tools are barbaric, you ain't seen nothing yet. Talk to somebody that is trained back in the 50s, 60s, 70s. I think people would be appalled at what is done. I'm not, because it works. Next.
Andrea, can e-collar be used for his territory issue?
Yes, it can be, but also dog training is going to be the number one thing. The e-collar will be the tool of choice for me, but the dog training methodology and everything that I do surrounding it will be more important. It's not just you're being territorial, correct. There's going to be a lot of other things. You can't just pick and choose. Next.
Julian, hi J&J. Glad you guys are doing safe and well. Just wanted to say how grateful I am for all the things that I've learned from you. My puppy is now 5 months old and heals off leash like a pro. Thank you.
Awesome. Awesome. Keep an eye on that dog. It's only 5 months old. There's going to be a lot of things coming up age-wise that your dog is more interested in than you. So be prepared. Next.
Dakota, sometimes my dog jumps and thrashes over dramatically when I'm training with Stim. It's usually on a 3. It's not malfunctioned. I tested it on myself. What should I do to stop this behavior?
Your dog is probably objecting. Correct it. Correct it with a leash. Correct it with a bonker. Your dog is just being like probably a drama queen. Next.
Cassie, 2 unfixed male does dogs 2 and 3 years. Can I keep them from marking our brand new playset? Thanks.
Yeah, get a remote collar on them, and every time they walk over to the playset and to mark, correct them. Next.
Truck driver, dog guy, my next glitch. My dog has started to lie down on the sit command. If I use upward pressure on the leash, he just lies extra heavy. NCS correction just confuses him in this scenario.
Yes, it does. So what you're going to do is stand in front of the dog and walk in. You're going to be using body pressure, spatial pressure. So you're walking right between the dog's legs, right into the dog's head while you're lifting up. Next. And also practice sitting in chairs. Next.
And also just be ready. If you say sit and you see him even thinking about laying down, don't let, give him the opportunity because it's going to be harder.
Just do a day of sit commands.
Yeah.
Next. And stop teaching sit to down.
Andy, I love the Patreon channel. Proud to be a member. The value is incredible for dog owners. Just saying.
All right. Thank you, Andy.
Sarah Bug. Been working with Kenai, who's reactive to everything. Dogs, cars, trains, people. Now we are down to only people, and he is showing real improvement. A simple leave it works most of the time.
Awesome.
Thank you for your videos and live. It's been amazing.
Awesome. And Sarah Bugart, the cool thing about it is when you went down that whole laundry list of like things that she was struggling with, mm-hmm. it just goes to show how much work she's done. Mm-hmm. That's what it does. That's what it boils down to. It's yeah. like you've just done a ton of work to knock away all those reactivity issues. It just means you've done a lot of work. Next.
Barista Boy, 90 and then 81 North, and just keep going.
Yep. I know it well.
Max and Tubbs, you're so damn right.
And then you're going to end up in Canada, too. Montreal, I believe.
Well, he said he's, like, on the Canadian border.
Yeah.
Super Cheeses, I trained our family pet starting when I was 13 with the Keeler method, which was tools as well, just different tools.
Yeah, Keeler method was also, a lot of people thought the Keeler method is harsh. I mean, that's all choke chain and long line.
Oh, yeah.
But it's like, it's a reason why it works. KMODT. It's a reason why it works. I mean, there is fairness to it, but it's a process. It's a process. Then there's a whole method for aggressive dogs. Next.
Max and Tubbs. My dad was ex-police dog handler from the 60s, and it was harsh, but you're right. With a working line GSD with very high prey drive, there's no way he listens to anything other than a hard correction.
And when Max and Tubbs says hard correction, these are corrections nobody's ever seen before. These are corrections that like none of you have seen before.
I think dogs were just different back then too, though.
They can take a correction.
They can take a correction.
Right now they crumble.
You gotta get real creative.
But now, I mean, a really good working line dog.
Yeah, we don't get those.
We don't get them. But they still make them. Yeah. I mean, they still have them. They have them working in the field.
Yeah.
But they also have a lot of working line dogs in the field that crumble. You know, literally. You know, there's that one video of the Secret Service sending a Malinois after someone that jumped a fence and the kid, it was a kid, kicked the dog in the chest and the freaking dog ran away. I'm like, are you serious? You ran away after you got kicked in the chest? What kind of freaking working dog are you? You know, what kind of working dog are you? Like, you should be able to get shot and stabbed and still fucking hold on to a bite. Mm. I mean, so yeah, people were, when they talk about correction, these were corrections that would make you shit your pants. But guess what? It worked. And they needed to make sure these dogs were proficient in their job. And if they were going to get washed out, I want to wash you out in training, not on the streets. Not when I need you. Not when I need you for life or death situations. Next. That's why they call certain dogs, that's why they call it bomb proofing. Because if you're not bomb proofed and you step on the bomb, not only do you die, but all the soldiers around you also die. Next.
Super Cheesus said, I'm here to learn the new tools.
Awesome. Yeah.
And on that note, that's the last one.
Is it really? Mm-hmm. Oh, wow. Holy shit. It's almost been an hour, too. Well, it's time for us to say goodbye. Yep. So it's been a nice show.
Sure has.
Tan looks good. You seem really tired.
I have a pounding headache.
Okay. Did you take anything? Mm-mm. Maybe it's all that coffee you've been drinking all day. How's your water? How many bottles of water did you go through today?
It's almost two of those.
Did you really? That's good. Okay, so you're hydrating enough. Mm-hmm. Gotta cut down on that caffeine, it's lady.
These lights are really hurting me. They're like literally blinding me.
Yeah. All right. I'm curious, why do you choose to have your personal pets intact? Well, only one of my personal pets is intact. The rest of them I got unintact. If I was to get a dog that was intact, I would leave it intact. Why? It's just a choice. It's just one of the many choices in lives that I make that are mine. I just feel that there's no need to do an unnecessary surgery on a dog that doesn't need it. And, you know, I've heard all the comments about, well, they can get testicular cancer. I'm like, yeah, but they can also freaking get cataracts and they can also get hit by a bus tomorrow and die.
Yeah, that's such an interesting.
You know what I mean? It's like a lot of things.
That's like, oh, let me remove my breasts because I could get breast
cancer. Right, right. Well, some people do that have a history of breast cancer in their family, you know.
Right, but like, how do you know if your dog does?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, the thing is this, is it's like, there's a lot of things that you could do, but I've chosen not to have her. Also, she's a clean heat dog. She does pretty well cleaning herself up. If I had a dog that was like a bloody mess and all my dogs were like, it caused massive disruption in the flow of the pack, I would probably reconsider it. Mm. I'd probably reconsider
Wes
it.
Yeah, Wes doesn't really give a shit either.
No. I think every time she was in the heat, though, the dogs are getting more and more curious.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think the last heat.
I think Bert's been more curious than Wes, though.
No, Wes showed more. It wasn't bad, but he showed more this time on the last heat than he ever has. Yeah. But it's still, like, not that
one
much.
One sniff.
Yeah.
Let's correct him for it.
Yeah, he's a one sniff wonder. Yep. Yeah. All right, guys. Madly in love with you. Take care, everyone. Have a fantastic night.
Good night.